Welcome, folks, to Storage Spotlight. Today, we'll be talking about best practices for running stateful workloads in GKE. First, a quick intro. My name is Manu Batra. I lead product for GKE and hybrid storage. Let's run through a quick overview of what all elements we'll be covering today. We're going to start with day two operations, some of the challenges our customers are facing around operating Kubernetes or large Kubernetes environments. Next thing we want to talk about is how we can enable customers to achieve critical application data protection service levels. A quick demo of our newest product, Backup for GKE. Moving to how we can help customers optimize GKE multi-writer storage with Filestore, and a quick demo of a newest feature, Filestore Multishare demo. So that should give us a good overview of some of the day-to-day challenges and how Google is bringing out new features and product to address them for newest generation of GKE workloads. So starting with, as we all hear from CNCF surveys, Kubernetes has crossed the chasm. Now customers are focused on scaling day two operations with 5.6 million developers using containers, which is an increase of 67% year over year. We're starting to see the problem shift to, I've deployed Kubernetes, I've deployed workloads in containers, but how do I scale and achieve my day two service levels? How do I achieve my data protection service levels? And customers are looking for polished and integrated, easy to use solutions out of the box that can help them achieve those service levels, especially around optimizing day two operations. So with that thought, the first thing we're gonna talk about is GKE application and data protection. So the common use cases we hear from customers often are, how do I roll back my application to a healthy state after a corruption or a user error? How do I accelerate my CI/CD pipelines and reduce errors? An example would be, I take a backup of a production, restore it in a test cluster, test all my upgrades, and then if all is successful, apply those upgrades to my production. How do I make that all seamless? Other use cases around, how do I scale and migrate my applications? If I have a new set of users coming up in a new region, how do I spin up new application clusters in that new region as quickly as possible? And of course, then the classic DR use cases around, my service levels for my critical tier 1, tier 1.5 applications require that I protect them from a zonal or a regional failure. How do I enable that? How do I achieve those critical service levels? And then, how can I archive data to achieve my compliance levels for long-term retention? So these are all common use cases that we hear from customers over and over again as they bring the next generation of Kubernetes workloads to GKE. To address this, Google recently announced a new product, Backup for GKE. Backup for GKE provides a Google Cloud managed service to protect Kubernetes workloads and persistent data for backup and disaster recovery. Essentially, the service helps customers unlock the most critical workloads they can bring to GKE, because now they're able to achieve the service levels and compliance levels that are required for their tier 1, tier 1.5 workloads that to develop and deploy on GKE. It's a service which is developed ground up. It's a Google native service which is completely integrated into GKE. As a user, you have complete control over what elements you want to back up. You can back up an application, you can back up a set of namespaces, or you can back up all namespaces in a cluster. So as a user, you have complete control and you can have a very fine-grained control over what gets backed up. You can also operate with flexibility. You can, on restore, you can choose where you want to restore the workloads. You want to restore it on the same cluster, you want to restore it in the same region, or you want to restore the workload across an entire region. So it completely unlocks the workload from the underlying infrastructure. So depending on the use case you're trying to achieve, you can actually restore those workloads anywhere, any region, any zone that you prefer. And of course, the service allows you to take complete control over policies around backup. You have complete control over how often we back up the data and the application, how long the data is retained, and it even has features like time lock, where if a policy enables time lock, the backups will be locked till the time lock expires. An example would be, I want to protect my data against ransomware and malicious deletions. I can lock the data for 90 days that no backups can be deleted unless the 90-day time lock expires. So as you see, backup for GKE allows you a complete control over what gets backed up, what policies are applied to the backups, and where it gets backed up. Double-clicking on the architecture of the product spans across three different layers. The lowest layer is the data layer, whereas it backs up any data that is living on Google Persistent Disk or Filestore in future. So any data that is living on Persistent Disk will take a copy of that, store it in the backup vault. The middle part is, as a user, you can define the scope of backup. You can define, I want to back up an entire set of namespaces in a cluster, a specific set of namespaces and applications, and we'll back up all the Kubernetes objects related to that scope. So we'll back up PVPC mappings, replica counts, any Kubernetes objects that are needed to recover that application successfully. The third layer, which is the topmost layer, is an optional layer, which is specially designed for applications that are app consistent, where most applications you can take crash consistent backups. But some applications require that you QS an application, flush all the writes, then take backups. So for applications that require very specific application constructs to be executed pre-backup and post-backup, backup for GKE supports pod-level scripts that can be executed. So as you see, backup for GKE operates at three different layers: the data layer, the Kubernetes orchestration layer, and the application layer to create app-consistent or crash-consistent backups. Let's get into and see the product, how it works, and see a live demo of backup for GKE. For the backup demo, we're going to do create two clusters, one a primary cluster called Postgres cluster. We're going to create the cluster in a rapid channel with 1.24. Next, we'll enable the backup for GKE add-on. We'll select specific machine types, in this case, E2 Standard 2, and our cluster is created. Now let's create the secondary cluster. Again, in rapid channel with 1.24, with similar machine types, enable backup for GKE. So now we have two clusters, one for backup, other we're going to restore that backup. Let's log into our primary cluster, deploy Postgres. Let's log into Postgres, create a table, and insert some data. Let's insert learning GKE is fun, database on GKE are easy. So when we take a backup and we restore, we'll check if the same table with the data can be retrieved on the restore cluster. So now let's go to backup for GKE, create a new backup plan. We have two clusters. We select the cluster we want to backup. We will give this backup plan a name. It's a Postgres plan, backup plan. We select the target where we want to store the data, and we have the backup plan. Let's take an instantaneous or a quick backup. This is a manual backup. We'll give this backup a name. And let's check if our backup's done. Our backup has succeeded. Now let's walk through the process to restore. Let's create a restore plan. Let's select where you want to restore. We want to restore all the namespaces in the backup. We want to create new volumes on backup. So we're selecting all the options for creating a backup plan. Let's keep default for restoration rules. Now let's go back to backup for GKE. We have a new backup for GKE, restore plan for Postgres. We have a new backup. Now let's restore this backup with the plan we just created into the new cluster. As you can see, our restore was successful. Now let's log into the new cluster and see if the data that we created on the primary cluster and all the config has been recreated into this new cluster. So my Postgres workload is recreated onto the Postgres cluster restore.
All my configs, storage classes, settings, PBVC claims are also restored. And the data that I took a backup for is already available. So that was a quick demo. Thank you so much.
Moving on, you just saw how backup for GKE can enable you to protect your most critical workloads and restore them in any region, any zone that you prefer. Next thing we want to talk about is how we can help optimize multi-writer storage with Filestore. Filestore has key advantages for GKE workloads. First thing is it can provide a consistent file system access across thousands of GKE nodes. Because it's multi-writer, you can actually have fast failover of pods from one node to another because you don't need to wait for detach to attach to the next node. And because of fast failovers, we can help customers achieve quick application upgrades. And as we talk about Filestore at an enterprise level, all storage upgrades are non-disruptive. And Ansys can achieve a 99.99% regional storage availability. With Filestore, we're introducing a new feature called Filestore Multishare for GKE, and it is designed to provide an optimized multi-writer storage for GKE pods, enabling admins to right-size NFS volumes. The smallest share can start at 10 gigs per share itself. So you can take a single instance and split it across hundreds of pods. All of this can be consumed with a simplified CSI driver. As a storage admin, you create a storage class, which is backed up by a Filestore instance. And then from that point on, as the application developers scale their applications, the multi-share will actually start allocating shares to different pods based on the policy that you have set. Let's get into a demo of Filestore Multishare for GKE.
Hi, Sean Darrington, Product Management here in Google Cloud. In this demonstration, I want to show you Filestore Enterprise and the new multi-share capabilities to use with your GKE clusters. So let's get started. So first of all, we're actually going to create a cluster in GKE. We're actually going to use the autopilot capabilities to make things simplified. I'm going to call this cluster stateful cluster. I'm also going to use rapid channel for the Filestore multi-share feature here. This is going to enable us to not only create the cluster, but then make sure that the cluster is properly connected. So I'm going to click create here, and now I'm going to begin to configure the managed storage with Filestore. This is going to use a CSI driver, the container storage interface for this. It's going to make it really simple to do. I'm also going to show you the YAML file here for the storage class. This shows you the storage class is using Filestore Enterprise, which is important, but you also want to make sure the multi-share is set to true. This is going to give you that functionality to have the smaller shares down to 10 gigabytes, if you will, within Filestore Enterprise. Now, once I do that, now I'm going to actually run the PVC YAML file, and you'll actually see that I'm going to do this with a single persistent volume in this provisioning process, and eventually be bound to the cluster. Now you can do this with multiple PVs if you want to, but in this instance, I'm just going to do one PV and 100 gig of the multi-share within Filestore Enterprise. Now, I'm not going to actually show you some of the YAML files for the reader and writer deployments. The reader pods are actually going to be exposed by the load balancer for users to view. And this is what I'm going to actually show you at the end here to show you how the multi-writer capability of Filestore supports this. We're going to just choose 20 writer pods. These will all simultaneously write to the same shared storage every 30 seconds. So in this case, it's writing to that one PB Filestore Enterprise that I created every 30 seconds. And I'll refresh it so you can see that increases. Also skip the YAML file for the load balancer. This basically just exposes the reader pod to Filestore. And here's the URL that I clicked on to actually show you that I've got 20 writer pods writing. And as I refresh this, you can actually see that it's recording all the writers that are writing to the shared NFS file system, the enterprise that I just created. It'll actually show you when I refresh this that the same writer host names match each other as you go through this. And that's as easy as it is to use Filestore Enterprise and the multi-share capabilities. Back to you, Manu.
Thank you, folks, for joining today for Storage Day. And I hope this session was helpful to learn about the critical features from storage that are coming to enable the next generation of GKE stateful workloads. Next, I want to bring in Ruben, who will be talking about next generation of Google Persistent Disk and some of the features coming out over there. Thanks so much for joining us today.